so oh, you do speak to them.
Yes. I'm partially deaf, so half the time I can So, oh boy, I am not a public speaker, and there is a ton of you. Well, Audra Holly already explained a few things, and if I was kind of a last minute thing, so I'm nothing prepared. So please excuse me if I go off on a tangent off into space this summer. Well, first, I'm Catherine Chaffee, and on December 27th of 2016, I received a double lung transplant. And as he was talking about the journey for a transplant, I never experienced any of that. I didn't know that, you know, sometimes they would get pagers or now they use their phones or anything. Since I was born with cystic fibrosis and diagnosed at 3 years old, cystic fibrosis is, you know, pretty much like your whole body produces a lot of new tissue. It's everywhere and it causes clogging for everything. It's really gross. And it's and it is a pretty gross genetic disease, and it affects all the organs. It can even affect reproductive organs, kidneys. This is a medication that we have to do with all the breathing treatments, all the physical therapy. I never got to experience, oh, we have this down, maybe talk about, you know, you might have to be put on the list, and everything got skipped. One month in October, I was my normal CF sick, and then things took a turn for worse in November, and I was pretty much, I skipped like stage 2 CF to like end stage CF, and they were like, oh, well, you're on your deathbed, and I was like, oh, cool. it happened pretty fast, and I don't really remember most of it. The hospital I was at AFC Medical Center, I was trying to keep me comfortable. We really didn't know how to handle my situation. They don't have a transplant team there. They don't have, all they have is CF team, and then regular doctors who help, like the soldiers that come home. And they were kind of at a loss. They tried to ask other transplant centers within San Antonio, Houston, and Dallas, and they all denied me. They were too risky. I had 2 forms of life support. I was severely underweight. I was pretty much not, from what I've heard, I was not a good candidate at all for transplant. And so they kind of gave my parents, she can't help her, you know, prepare a funeral. And we didn't want to give up. My parents didn't want to give up. So they called my uncle, Peter Mayhew, who is Chewbacca in the Star Wars movies, and I've known him since I was very little, so he's been a huge part of my life. And he outreached to as many people as he could, and finally he got to J.R. Stosis, and J.R. tells this story, and I'm going to tell the short version. Basically, he called,
Dr. Mazziota.
Yeah, Mazziota, and kind of tricked him. He's saying, oh, I want to do an interview, and he's like, I like you, you know, I need help, I need you to look at this this girl that she, you know, she needs to give it a chance. And my parents always said, during that time, all they needed was one doctor, one yes, and we got that one doctor and one yes. And so, I was completely opposite at the time. They were giving me so many drugs to keep me, you know, comfortable and everything. And of course, they were playing movies for me constantly. But what really, really, really helped save my life was the ECMO. Unfortunately, I was very, very tiny for a 26-year-old, and they couldn't get into the neck at all. There was too scar tissue. I was too small. So they ended up putting it in my legs. And so that was a very difficult challenge on itself, because I have restless legs, and I was moving my legs a lot, and the nurses would yell at me, take me off your legs. And he let me walk. And I, you know, these things fall out of me while I'm walking and trying to survive, or, you know, I either stay in bed and move my legs a lot. So they conceded, and they let me walk around with ECMO in my legs. And then finally they transferred me on a E-130 plane from Vance Medical to UCLA. And they were, I remember my parents always saying that they were amazed that as soon as I got to UCLA, I wanted to walk. And the nurses there didn't want to. They're like, no, you haven't been handsome in your life. That's not possible. I'm like, well, watch me. And so, of course, every day I was walking, even when I didn't want to, but they said, of course, me too. It was difficult, but again, everybody at the other hospital and a lot of people, they didn't give me a chance, and I kind of have a thing where I kind of like proving people wrong. So, you know, they're like, oh, well, you can't do this, you can't do that, and I'm like, again, watch me. And I would do it, and I would try to push the limit. We got the call. I remember when a nurse came in to tell me, hey, got new lungs. You know, we got the call, and I was so excited, and I still had a trach, but I was secretly working with some of my night nurses to teach me how to talk with a trach. And I think they kind of regretted it after that, because I talk a lot. And so I grabbed my phone, which I hadn't touched my cell phone in the 45 days that it all started. And I called my dad on his birthday while he was having something. I think my mom and him were celebrating down the street, and that was only 26. And I called him, and my parents tell me that they were so scared because they saw my phone number. And they're like, oh God, something happened. And of course, they answered intently, hello. And I'm like, I can't do it now, but I sounded like Smeagol. I'm like, guess what? I got new lungs. You gotta come here. And they were like, okay. They hung up. And my parents said they just sat there. They're like, wait, was that Kathleen telling us? But she can't talk. She has a thing. And they're like, well, of course, she find out a way to do it. So I got my lung. I should have really had time to write something. I am all over the place. For the transplant, I have to go back. They told me I was on the list on, I think, the 12th. And then literally 2 weeks later, I got my lung. And we were not prepared. We didn't even have that little book that tells us, oh, how to prepare for your transplant. And I was like, no, I got my transplant. They came in, threw the book at us, and they're like, read it. And I'm like, oh, okay. Okay. And so we read it, and they were like, oh, you can't have this, you can't have that. And I love food. So the most devastating thing to me in the whole world was they're like, you can't have pickles. You can't have beef jerky. You gotta be careful. I'm from Texas, and we love our meat like medium rare and stuff. And like you gotta have like medium well done. What am I gonna do? And so the list kept going on, and you know, again, we're not prepared. And I just wanted to split the table and be like, what was the point if we have lungs that can't eat everything in the world? But. Thankfully, they over time they're like, yes, you can have pickles. Yes, you can have beef jerky. Yes, you could do this. Just don't be stupid. And Dr. Thayer has told me, like, can I have this? And it's like, yeah, just don't be stupid. So I'm like, okay. And that always rings in my head every time. I'm like, I want sushi. And then he's like, don't be stupid. Like, oh, no. It's been a year, but since it was so close to the end of the year, it's actually 2 years since I had my lung transplant, and so far I have had really no bumps at all. And I have a dog, well, two now, and I used to never be able to keep up with her. She was actually my service dog for the longest time too. So bright. But now, I can play with her, and I can wrestle with her, and I can also wrestle with my Great Dane at home, too, which I would never thought possible. I can swim again, and I can go upstairs. is so great without being winded. I think the greatest thing is I get to spend more time with my family. Everything happens so fast, and you know, it put into perspective that I need to spend more time with my family, with my friends. And you know, in the beginning, I was always told if I got a transplant, my average lifespan would be like 5 years. And I, you know, it's just it always scared me. So I was like, well, do I even want a transplant? And, you know, if I'm only gonna get 5 years, I mean, that's still a good amount of time. But I actually had to try to not cry earlier when either one of you were standing up and the tears were getting longer and longer, like 30, beyond 30 years, it gives me such a ray of hope that, you know, hey, I can do that. You know, if I keep up and I can do that, there's hope that I can live to be an old grandma sitting on our porch. And yelling at little kids, you know, my lucky lot. You know, I want to see that in my future, and you know, seeing how it's amazing. I think that's it. But I want to leave off with something that CFers always say, and I don't, none of us know who came up with it, but it's a saying that life isn't measured like a breath we take, but the moments that take our breath away. And I've had several moments from the transplant, actually throughout my whole life, and this is definitely one of the biggest moments that take my breath away. Like anxiety settings. But it's so amazing. Every one of you is so beautiful.